up by these two guys in a dark blue Mercedes Benz. I was hitchhiking on the highway. It was pouring rain, and I mean, there was something bad that had happened to me when I was hitchhiking in the rain in San Francisco the year before. But it wasn't going to happen to me this time. This was Holland, you know, Dankjewel and all that. Anyway, I got in, and pretty soon I realized that the men were German. They weren't Dutch after all, and they had these accents. They were elegant. Their dark blue suits matched the car. One of them was bald, and he was at least 70. The other at least 50. You know where they must have been in World War II? I'm Jewish, but not really. No one ever talked about that kind of thing in my neighborhood, not even the couple who had these numbers on their arms. You know, they worked in the corner grocery store. I told the men that my name was Shelley Hirsch. They must have known it was a Jewish name. I showed them the little paper that Heinz's address was on. He lived in Castle. I met him on the Dom Square, and he looked like the other strong, quiet types I'd been attracted to, but he had blonde, scraggly hair. I was so nervous. Suddenly, we're going off the highway, and we stopped at that address I'd given them, and they must have known it was, they got out of the car, and they rang the bell. Where was Heinz? The man got back in the car. They said they were gonna take care of me. And we drove and drove to a forest. Now I love nature, but it was after the rain and everything was dripping. It reminded me of those Grimm's fairy tales. I loved them, but they were brutal. We kept driving through droplets of rain. They pulled up to this house. It looked like a gingerbread house. They let me out so gracefully. The older man had a cane. A woman came to the door, and she had a dirndl dress on and clogs and hairy legs, like I did when I worked at the donut shop in San Francisco. They told me to come sit down at a beautiful table, and there was a fireplace, and they ordered potato soup for me. I loved it. There were little frankfurters in it, and after I ate, they said they couldn't just leave me there. They would take me back to Heinz's house. How could they be so nice? So nice! I was so glad to shed those kind of prejudices off my body. Something was coming over me. I was feeling so liberated, so free. They drove me to Heinz's house, and he still wasn't home, so they rang the bell of a neighbor and asked if I could stay there until Heinz came home. Oh, he moved like a girl, like yogis I'd seen. Drinking tea from porcelain bowls. And then
I came to see
these women, 10 of them on the marble mantelpiece. They were all made of plaster, and none of them had any heads. Gay men liked women. Anyway, it was still the fear factor had already dissipated. The record had ended. It was pictures at an exhibition. Some sound, and it was Heinz walking up the stairs, very slowly. slowly. I grabbed my knapsack and walked to the door. I stopped to put on my shoes. They hadn't yet dried from the walk in the rain. I opened the door and there was Heinz. His hair looked even scragglier than it did when I met him on the Dom Square. And he looked very pale. He didn't seem so happy to see me, but I followed him up the stairs and he opened up the door. There were green sheets hung sloppily across the windows, and there was a small wooden table filled with cigarette butts and packs of cigarettes. I didn't really know what to do. Heinz just walked into the other room and sat down in a ratty stuffed chair. He was clearly very ill. I asked if there was anything I could do to help. He didn't speak much English. I told him I would take care of him, but I don't know if he really heard me. He just got into bed. I don't know where I slept that night. I guess I slept with him. But I know that the next day I headed out to document it, to see some art alone. It was so weird. I didn't want to see all of those advertisements for Marlboro cigarettes and beer. I don't know, maybe it was some Andy Warhol prints I was looking at, but anyway, I left Documenta after an hour and stopped for a while watching the ducks waddle up the canal, and then I went back to Heinz's apartment. There was a putrid smell in the flat, and Heinz looked even worse than when I had left. I don't know how I knew, but he was going cold turkey. Heroin. I would just stay until he got better. It seemed like days that I was there. The TV was always on. His eyes were mostly closed. The Olympics were on TV. It was taking place in Munich that year. Munich was only a few hours away from where we were. There was a little stool beside the bed. I think I had just gone to sit on it when I heard the shots and I saw the Israeli athletes killed on TV. September 6th, 1972. I don't know when I left and hitchhiked back to Amsterdam. I imagine that I waited till Heinz was okay.